the bell icon on YouTube and don't miss another update.
There's a new clamor on Kashmir now from three categories of people. One, Modi critics in India. Second, the old foreign policy conservatives. And third, the old legion of cold warriors in India. And what is that clamor? That clamor is that Kashmir has now become internationalized. Why? Because many foreign leaders have now spoken on Kashmir. Bernie Sanders, who is a US presidential candidate, not candidate as yet, he is among the three front runners. In fact, behind the front runner in the Democratic race for the Democratic nomination, he is not yet a candidate. Jeremy Corbyn, who looks like pretty much the Labour candidate in Britain for when elections are held there. Several Democratic congressmen in America, including Ilhan Omar, who is quite high profile, of Somalian extraction, Muslim, who does speak out quite strongly on many of these causes and who does draw a lot of adverse and I must say uncivil attention from Donald Trump as well. In addition, there are some others. There is the Deputy Prime Minister of Sweden, Deputy Prime Minister who also holds the portfolio for foreign affairs. So many of these voices have now emerged, and these voices are now emerging in the large echo caused by the Western media, the Western liberal media, which by and large, I would say almost 100%, if not 100%, 99 point something percent has taken a position which is very critical of Government of India's decisions, changes, policies in Kashmir, particularly when it comes to communication clampdown, other curbs on civil liberties, etc., etc. Now, that this has become internationalized again is a reality. Also, it is true that the United Nations Security Council, it did not quite take it up the way Imran Khan would like you to believe, but they did have an informal closed-door meeting, or maybe not so informal either, but a closed-door meeting where they discussed this. There was no resolutions, there was no statement, but they discussed it. So it's true that after 55 years almost, Kashmir was discussed by the Security Council at some level in some way. So one, that this issue has become internationalized, there is no doubt about. And that it has become internationalized as a result of Modi government's sudden abrogation of Article 370, 35A, the change of the status of Jammu and Kashmir into two union territories, that also is a reality. Now we go to the next aspects of it, and I am looking at three different elements. One, why is this happening? Second, is it a good thing? And third, is it a bad thing? Why am I not saying good thing or a bad thing? Because in some ways it's a good thing and some ways it's a bad thing. So first of all, why is it happening? Why this is happening is, if you see this pattern, it's very clear. Almost the entire criticism of this new turn on Kashmir by the Modi government is coming from the Western left or the Western liberal left, more left than liberal, but I think both are pretty much the same, because if you look at the Western media, the New York Times, Washington Post, Economist, it's now it is liberal, it's not left, but it is liberal. The BBC, which is liberal and left, many others, Al Jazeera, in fact, I need to do a separate one someday to explain what I think Al Jazeera is. Essentially, it is the Qatar royal family's enterprise to fight their own ideological battle with the Saudi royal family, but that is something in which I will go into later. Right now, let us treat it as a strong, powerful voice in global media, strong, powerful, generally liberal voice in global media. So all the coverage in all these institutions and any others has been critical of India, if not hostile. And this is also reflecting now in this, what was being said earlier in the liberal, left liberal commentariat around the world is now reflecting in the views of many of these public figures, also of the liberal left. That's why such strong views from Jeremy Corbyn, Bernie Sanders, Ilhan Omar, I'm waiting for Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, so many of them. Now, this is, why is this happening? This is happening because this is a very polarized global intellectual and political environment right now. So, in America, the entire liberal lot hates Donald Trump just as he hates them. It's a completely polarized situation. So, Trump has his base, then there is the other base. For that base, a bunch of these Democratic candidates are now fighting. And these Democratic candidates, I think there is a competition to see who can be more left than the rest, although some have positioned themselves like that. Biden might be the most centrist of them all. The rest are all left of Biden and some are to the extreme left. Bernie Sanders, but when you go on to these four women parliamentarians or congresswomen who Trump keeps targeting, then that is way to the left, and the argument amongst themselves is very strong. In fact, they are constantly attacking each other for not being left enough. In fact, that is something that Barack Obama had described just the other day as the American liberals or Democrats' circular firing squad, that all of you are standing in a circle and shooting each other instead of shooting your adversaries. So, this is very competitive liberalism that's now going on in America. And America, in many ways, in American politics, media, culture, that drives a lot of the global argument. Second, Jeremy Corbyn. For Corbyn, besides the fact that the British Labour has an old nostalgia about Kashmir, about India, about the partition of India, they essentially see it as part of the unfinished business of partition, and they think it was their responsibility to complete it, but they did not fulfill their responsibility. That's why this patient was left open on the operating table, not stitched back, and that is what is causing the problem. So, maybe they owe it to us. This is their sort of view of white man's burden. They owe it to the people of Kashmir and the subcontinent to come and settle this problem. They tried doing this in the 60s. Today, frankly, who cares? But still. But the second thing is that for Jeremy Corbyn, Labour has a very strong support base among immigrants from Muslim countries, and many of them are from Pakistan, and among them also many are from, a very large number are from the Pakistani side of Kashmir, people who are called Mirpuris. They speak a kind of Punjabi, they don't speak a language which has any resemblance to what is spoken in our valley. But that's a strong voter base. In fact, sometimes I keep on saying that you have to win Bradford. After all, I use that Bradford metaphor, that Corbyn has to say these things because he has to win Bradford, because Bradford is an area which has a strong Mirpuri population, and Labour traditionally wins all three seats from there. So, this is constituency pressure. Once again in America, for the American left, Democrats in general, but American left, because Democrats are now, they are ranged over quite a wide sort of arc of ideological arc now. So, Democrats on the left, they see a very strong vote bank among Muslim immigrants in America. There is a global sort of, closing of ranks, and we can talk about this some other time. There's a global closing of ranks between the left, the left intelligentsia, and the pan-Islamic movements and causes. I think essentially it comes first from sympathy for the underdog. That's the Western liberal sees Muslims coming from these countries where they are being victimized by their regimes, and they are finding refuge in Canada, America, Europe, elsewhere, now Rohingyas in Bangladesh. They see them as victims, so they treat them as underdogs. Second, there's a general common shared dislike. I'm resisting saying hatred, but let me not do so. It is hatred of the right, and particularly many rulers of the or elected leaders of the right. Put Donald Trump on top of them, put Theresa May earlier and now Boris Johnson there. But to the extent that it matters to us in India, it's important to put Narendra Modi also right up there, because I have said many times, this is a world run by alpha males of the right. So there, against them, the global, particularly Western left, and the pan-Islamic forces, I am not saying ISIS, the pan-Islamic political forces, who really don't have much ability or space for politics back home, where they come from, which is why they become refugees in most cases, they have now made common cause against this, what they see as this evil alliance of global right and global conservatives and the global dictatorial alpha males. So then, if Donald Trump and Modi are put in the same category, and you also have your vote bank politics because you want votes of these immigrants, then it's a no-brainer that you build this politics. Now, couple of other things also underlie that. One, if Muslim voters in Muslim immigrant voters in Britain and America are such a powerful magnet, then why are Indian voters, Indian non-Muslim voters or immigrants, because a majority of Indian immigrants in these countries are, they reflect India's demographic pattern. So why are they not a force? That is because over the past decades, particularly last 25 years or so, Indians by and large in America, in Britain, in the rest of Europe, even in South Africa of all places, they have swung right, because Indian immigrants almost in every country have done well for themselves socially and economically. And as they have done so, they have started to identify with the right, not with Labour and Democrats and the left anymore, particularly because everybody is class conscious, and in India, in the case of us Indians, we are also caste conscious, and we are also socially very hierarchical. So we see us as Indian immigrants, progressive, the richest, second richest in America, the best educated, and then we see other minorities who come from Africa, who come from Arab countries, who come from Pakistan, who come from any of these places, essentially Muslims, who are not doing as well. So we Indian, I avoid using the expression diaspora, the Indian immigrants have generally moved away from the left to the right. So that's not a vote that now, say, Bernie Sanders or Joe Biden expect to get. In fact, I haven't seen any data, I'm not sure polls are being done like that, but my guess would be that in an election now, 80 to 90% of Indian origin immigrants will vote Trump or will vote Republican. That's a big change, and some of that will reflect in Britain as well, not all, but frankly I think quite a lot of that will reflect in Britain as well. So there has been an alignment of Indian politics, of the face most representative of India, that is Modi, and Indian policies, and the Indian immigrant voters' preferences with the global right. That's a reality. You can say it's a good thing or a bad thing, but that's a reality. So this reaction from the global left reflects a lot of that. And that is something that you have to now take as a given. Now, even if you go back and check in these countries, and once again, because we are more familiar with Britain and America, and that's where the media, most of the media that matters to us is also located, I will take you back there. Why is Tony Blair disliked so much by the left and by the Labour in Britain? That's because of his 10 years in power, 6 coincided with George Bush Jr., who was a man of the right, who the left hated. Except now it turns out that they hate Trump a lot more than they hated George Bush Jr. But Blair became George Bush Jr.'s ally in the war on terror. Then why is Obama not liked so much, and why is Obama now being so critical of this lot of new Democratic leaders? Because Obama is something who not only continued that war on terror, he actually made it even more brutal and intense. Remember, it was in his time that drone attacks went up, bombings went up, the interventions in the Middle East went up, and not just that, it was in his time when Osama bin Laden was killed in that raid and in the manner that he was killed and the body was disposed of. So he, once in power, he was not a liberal icon. So today there is a reaction even among the voters of the Democrats in America, the Labour in Britain, and that reflects in all of this. So this is a given. This is now bound to happen. Having said this, the chances, first of all, that Bernie Sanders would become the candidate are low. I think Joe Biden would know better, because remember, Biden was Obama's vice president. And they inherited the nuclear deal from George Bush, for which Manmohan Singh was hated in India by India's left, including the left within the Congress. But that deal, that baton was carried with panache by Barack Obama. And that policy shift continued. So Biden understands what this was about. So I don't, so chances today are, as of today, he is ahead. Then there are Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren. I think all the others have now fallen by the wayside. So we'll see what will happen. And then also we have to see who actually wins that election. Do the Democrats actually have a chance of winning? And once you win, then you get to know the facts. Remember, again, go back. Clinton won was the most hostile American government for India in a very long time. That's when Robin Riffel actually questioned the instrument of accession. She tried to say later that she was misquoted, or she made a rhetorical point. She was not misquoted. This was a story in the Indian Express by Bharat Bhushan, who was the correspondent there. He's a first-class correspondent. He'll never get facts like that wrong. So, and Clinton one was very hostile to India, and go back, that was early 90s. That is when India was under so much pressure in Kashmir. That is the Haider phase of Kashmir history. And Punjab was burning, and Narsimha Rao was dealing with all this very brutally. Cold War had ended, the Americans had won. It was a government administration very hostile to India. That's when India faced a challenge at the UN Human Rights Commission. Now, we've spoken about the history of how Narasimha Rao handled it. But the fact is that between Clinton 1 and Clinton 2, the situation had changed dramatically. So the same Clinton who was in his first term so hostile to India then became India's best friend. Look at the role he played in Kargil, and look at the role he played in easing the sanctions after the nuclear tests and restoring not just normalcy in the Indo-US relationship, but also improving India's relations with the Western world and among his allies, and also building the foundation of a very strong strategic partnership with India, which is something that George Bush then built on. So there is continuity in American policy. First of all, I don't see great prospects today of Bernie Sanders becoming the president. But even if it does, the realities of global politics will confront whoever becomes a new president, and they'll have to look at things. So you can react to these things, but if you look at it in terms of India's national point of view, I would not worry so much about it. Now, why do I say so? Because the negative thing is, first of all, that India is just literally and metaphorically getting the bad press. It's also giving a handle to Narendra Modi's critics, which is fair because this is politics. But one, this goes deeper into the public opinion in the Western countries. So they will not sit back and question everything. And even if a new government comes, this impression that a lot of people were tortured, their rights were denied, etc., etc., this will remain. Second, you might say that Donald Trump is not impressed by what New York Times says or Washington Post says. But just as he has his base, there is also another base. And there is a convergence of that base. That base spreads across the media, liberal academia, and the Democratic Party. And Democratic Party now is different from what it was under Obama. Ditto in Britain, media, liberal academia, and the Labour Party. This is a potent combination, and that's what we are seeing in Sweden also. And once again, we will see many such things happening in European Union as well, because that is where small countries also have a voice. They are all equals in that community. So that is important. That is the negative. So obviously, Kashmir has now become internationalized. It will be raised many times in many forums. Now it's India's choice on whether India wants to be irritated with this and respond to this or take it in its stride. Because today this situation is very different from 1991 to 93. First, the time when Kashmir had got truly and seriously internationalized in a manner that it gravely threatened India's interests was that 91 to 93, 94 period when Cold War had ended, Soviet Union had disappeared as India's only ally. India was having to refix its politics. India had a big economic crisis. Punjab and Kashmir were burning. India had had the assassination of Rajiv Gandhi and a great deal of instability. And even Narasimha Rao's government was a minority government which was being constantly rocked from within and from outside. So that is when this internationalization was a threat. Today it is an irritant. For sure, a threat? No. Because if you take out the noise and the irritants and go to the level where people take decisions, all of this will not impress any of the people taking decisions in the world right now. Your problems might arise with Xi Jinping, but not because he is reading Ilhan Omar's tweets or editorials in the New York Times. You might have problems with him because he thinks that this has made India a little bit weaker, so he can push India a little bit more in some other direction. That is something that India's diplomacy has to deal with. Now, I also told you that the third part, there are some positives to this also, and I will conclude on that note. The biggest positive is, what does India want on Kashmir? Now, I know that this is a contentious thing, but the fact is that, and there are parliament resolutions, so people, when I say this, people on the Indian side will our side will get upset, people on the Pakistani side will get upset, and people on the liberal side all over will get upset, and people on the conservative side also get upset, but such is my fate. So on the Indian side, while there is a parliament resolution saying we'll recover every square inch of Kashmir's territory that Pakistanis have, including what they gifted to China, that is Shaks Kam Valley. We had talked about it in CTC 235. There is no realistic hope of getting any of that territory back. So India's move now, it's quite evident, even you can see it with Rajnath Singh's statement that we are willing to talk to Pakistan, but about POK. India's view is consistent since 1972, never stated publicly, but consistent that India is quite happy to have line of control as the permanent border. You keep what you have, we keep what we have. On the Pakistani side, there is always this desperation in the establishment there in the military to take something more from India, some consolation prize, at least if not the valley or not a lot of territory. That is, this Indian government has now decided will not be given. But it is possible to talk about, I think, as I read between the lines, to talk about a settlement whereby India can give up its claim on the rest of Kashmir, which the Pakistanis have, which is a lot of Kashmir. Now, these global pressures, if the global community gets so concerned about Kashmir, it is very possible with right diplomacy and politics from India and some friends of India to push this in that direction and a final round of negotiations and a final settlement. And I can tell you, whenever there is a settlement, whether it happens the next 5 years or next 500 years, whenever there is a settlement, it will be a settlement accepting this line of control as the border between the two countries. So there, if that is the objective and that is the intention, then I think this internationalization might even be a good idea. You know, that is game of jiu-jitsu. What is somebody's strength can also be somebody's weakness. What is your weakness can also be your strength. So India can use it like that, but finally with one condition. And that condition is, think about why India was under such threat and pressure and treated so badly by the Western community particularly America, Clinton won between 1991, I would say between 1989 and 93. Why? Because India was an economic disaster. India had political instability. It was also an economic disaster. In 1991, India was on the verge of a balance of payments crisis. And then Narasimha Rao and Manmohan Singh started reform, and India's economy picked up and global investments began coming in. Global brands began coming in. Suddenly people discovered the talent of Indians, and India became a market. India also became a place where you found talent. It also became a moral, economic and political counterpoint to China. So that growth is what has kept driving India all this while. That's the reason policy changed between Clinton 1 and Clinton 2, and then was driven in the same direction a bit faster actually by Bush in his two terms, and then Obama in his two terms as well. So if India continues to grow, and that is the big if in capital letters, India has stopped growing lately. And if you've seen the figures, recent figures, they are quite alarming. The implication of those figures is on jobs, it's on economic distress, economic well-being of us Indians, particularly the poor within our country. But there are strong implications of that on India's strategic interests as well. This quarter, for the first time, God knows in how many years, maybe a couple of decades, India's growth rate was lower than Pakistan's. I know nobody likes hearing this, but it is Pakistan's 5.2, India is 5. India has to go get back up to 7, 7.5, carry out the reforms that are needed. That is today not just an economic requirement, that's a strategic and defense requirement, because having made this big move on Kashmir, having taken the risk of internationalizing Kashmir, having internationalized Kashmir, the weapon that India will have, the muscle that India will have to sort of railroad through all this will not be how many more fighter planes it buys, or how many more BrahMos missiles it builds, or how many more S-400s it buys, or whether it orders more howitzers from the Americans. The muscle, the ammunition, the mega tonnage that will push India through this, and that will enable India to take full advantage of this very risky move, will be to get its economy growing back up at the level at which the world can no longer, forget ignoring India, but can no longer take pangas with India.